Be with us on this first Sunday of New Year's, and the reason why we have this big 2014, I mean, boy, oh boy, who would ever think, huh? We're well into this new century, and boy, I'll tell you, if you think about it, and you know, I've been praying and sensing from the Lord God that 2014 needs to be, for us, a clean break from 2013. And why do I say that? Well, there were some defining moments of clear advances of spiritual life of Christ in you. And on the other hand, there's evidences that stagnation or even backpedaling by some is becoming commonplace, and I want to tell you that in God's eyes, that's unacceptable. Amen. We are God's people. If you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, He gave you His Holy Spirit. He is living in you. The Bible even calls it Christ in you, the hope of glory. You are a different person with Christ living in you. And so I think it's vital that we face ourselves here in 2014. Because when Christ came to live, to indwell you, He didn't, as you know, save you to go right to heaven, did He? He kept you here because He wanted to show you off like He did Job. Right? And Job didn't stagnate in his faith, even with all the things that happened to him. All the amazing trials and testings that he went through. The physical, the spiritual, the suggestions by some of his family members, his so-called friends, right? He stayed firm. And that is what I am suggesting happens here in 2014. That we not only set ourselves firm in the faith, but even grow to a greater Christ-likeness together. And so that's going to be our focus here for I don't know how long, for a few weeks. Anyhow, the first month or two maybe. I'm not going to give you any illustrations or examples of behavior that God thinks is unacceptable. I prefer to give you examples of Christ because light reveals darkness. And who Christ is and what He does and how He lived is a great indicator of what you should be. So there's a great verse in the Old Testament book of Micah. And chapter 6, it tells us what light bearers do. So I want to invite you to take your Bibles and to look in the Old Testament book of Micah. And it's tucked just about in a little bit more than halfway through. Chapter 6 and verse 8. And I've kind of made this my focus verse for the year. Because this is an indicator that if you have this desire that's mentioned in this verse, then that's an indicator that you desire to grow spiritually. You desire to advance in your walk with the King. So here's the verse. He has told you, old man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God.
Amen.
Micah 6:8. And so it's when you talk about a New Year's resolution, you know, I don't personally make any, but we're calling it this today and next week, the idea of resolution. But what we want to do in this resolution here, of 2014 is to do a re-evaluation. So I don't know if I put that up. There it is. Re-evaluate. And that's, I think, part of your notes of what we're going to do. Re-evaluate your life in Christ. Because walking with Jesus impacts your life. The way you think, speak, act, behave, react, and respond. Walking with Jesus. Now, I'm saying going beyond just the fact of saying, oh, I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I'm talking about being walking redeemed. So it's going to impact your life, the way you think, speak, act, behave, react, even respond to things. Jesus' life impact is a growing investment, so every year is a life change year. You're growing. That's why I suggest that we leave 2013 behind. And let's forge ahead. Let's grow together. So we're calling it a re-evaluation. The call for 2014. Is my life bearing the light of Jesus for all to see? Or are we out of sync with Him? So in doing this re-evaluation, I think it's important that we ask a few questions. And so the first question I want you to ask is, where am I? Well, I'm in Bristol. Come on. I'm in the carriage house at AGF. No, I'm saying reevaluate your spiritual growth and that pattern of spiritual growth. Where am I spiritually? So I want to take you to a couple of passages of Scripture. The first I want you to turn to is Psalm 139. And this is going to be another pivotal verse that we're going to work through in our sessions here beyond just Micah. We want to look at continually Psalm 139. Because in here are some very amazing words and it's an intriguing perception of Almighty God. Absolutely amazing. Psalm 139, 7 through 13. In fact, you know, I think I'm going to start right from the beginning because I was up in the middle of the night and the Lord took me to this passage. And instead of starting in verse 7, He started me right at the beginning. I like this. Oh Lord, You have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, You know it all together. You hem me in behind and before and lay Your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. Now verse 7. Where shall I go from Your Spirit? Or where shall I flee from Your presence? If I ascend to heaven, You are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, You are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there Your hand shall lead me, and Your right hand shall hold me. If I shall say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to You. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light with You. For You formed me in my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. So did you catch that in the early part of the verses? You know, He is all around you. Wherever you go. And I'll give you a crude illustration, and this is very bad, but just kind of envision in your mind, you know, when the Charlie Brown cartoons came out for Christmas, right? You know, when the kids, you know Charlie Brown's Christmas tree, right? Mm-hmm. And when the kids are at the pageant and they're doing their little dance, you know, some go like this. just something that we've always kind of giggled at. Charlie Brown had a friend called Pigpen, right? And as he walked along, what followed right along with him? The thing of dirt and dust and all that sort of thing, you know? Crude illustration, but you know, just the way that dust followed him, that's God in the manner that he is around us, although we can't see him. So we're asking the question, where am I? And with Psalm 139, we're asking with God. Where am I with God? How are things with me and the Almighty? And what we want to do is reevaluate where we are with God. Are you aware of His every moment, every place with you presence? Does it matter to you that He sees what you do, knows where you go, knows what you think, is aware of what you look at? But He's not a police detector. He's a loving, saving comforter. That's what those verses say. He's there. Close to you. With you. His presence is there. And at verse 13, He understands you. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. So not only reevaluate where you are with God, but reevaluate your relationship with Him. The Creator knows you better than you know yourself. Are you willing to surrender all to Him? A reevaluation of your relationship with Him is absolutely necessary this year, 2014. And we're asking you to commit yourself to a deeper walk, a stronger prayer life, a daily Bible encounter, and an openness to serve, shine, and share Christ where you work, live, and play. Because you see, once that vertical gets in check, your relation with the Almighty, the horizontal begins to come into play. And so we want to talk about not only where I am with God, but where am I with others? Because, see, that's why we were left here. To allow God to impact us with others. To shine His light. And so the portion of scripture I have here is 1 Corinthians 6. And so if you turn there, Chapter 6, verses 8 through 11. And some of these words are very strong that Paul gives. He's in the midst of a very problematic church. And their relationship with the Almighty had been stunted because of self-desires. And some of their relationship with mankind wasn't good. Now, 1 Corinthians 6, 8 through 11 are the verses I want to focus in on. They begin with some very shocking statements, but ends with some very encouraging words. 1 Corinthians 6, 8. But you yourselves wrong and defraud even your own brothers. Now, I want to bring this to your attention, you know, because the body of Christ is well known by those on the outside to be hypocrites, right? And ones that love to shoot their own. And God has called us to something completely different than that. Our relationship with others includes not only those on the outside, but those within the body. And very much like those on the outside, even without Christ, who have some very, very troubled situations in their life, people within the body have some very troubled things in their life too. But wonderfully, we have a buffer. We have Almighty God on our side. He's there all around us, like it says. He's there embracing us, holding us, loving us. And shame on us when we go to the place that we defraud even our own brothers and sisters in Christ. Then verse 9 gets even more shocking. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? And then he gives a list. Very interesting words here in the latter part of verse 9 going into verse 10. Do not be deceived, neither the sexual immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. In other words, this is not kingdom activity. The body of Christ is different. So unrighteousness will not inherit the kingdom of God. Remember back in Micah 6, verse 8, talked about do justly. That's being righteous. Right living, essentially, is what that is. And so, when we talk about with others, where am I? With God? With others? Look what it says now in verse 11. He says, and such were some of you. And can I say this? And such were some of us. Right? When we were non-kingdom dwellers, this kind of lifestyle, maybe not to great extents, but in some ways, were there. But such were some of you. And here's the distinction, dearly beloved, from the way we were to the way we now are. You were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. You know, by simple faith in Christ, recognizing your sin, coming to Him, desiring His life in you, desiring to banish your own life, the washing began. The sanctification began. The cleansing began. And the justification begins. And so we have a problem. And that is, we were people of unrighteousness at one time. And verses 8 through 10 talk about divisions and disenfranchising that discredits grace and reveals unrighteousness. And the key words are there. Because the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't be deceived, he says. Don't be deceived. So verse 8a talks about bad behavior in the body. And in some ways, we get caught up into that. And at times, we can even devour one another. That's why Peter says in 1 Peter 5:8, that very thing, that the enemy wants to do that thing. He wants to get us to the place that we devour. He's seeking whom he may devour. And of course, we go right along with it. So just like our reevaluation with God, we reevaluation our life with others. And there must be a resolve. And there it is. Verse 11. Such were some of you. Such were. The key word, were. The past life, not the present life system. So there's the resolve, and that is the kingdom. Kingdom dwellers no longer display sinister, sinful, snarly ways. You are righteous, so you live righteous. Why? Because you're washed, sanctified, justified. And how? In Christ's name and by Christ's Spirit. I thought about that because I thought, you know, washing and sanctification is very, very similar, right? But spiritually, we can't wash ourselves, can we? Clean to become sinless. That's God's work. It says it's the Holy Spirit that cleanses us in Titus. But the thing of sanctification is that we have a daily pattern that we can put into place of that washing that we have. And so we can be daily walking in sanctification. And He's justified us in Christ's name and by His Spirit. So it's evaluation time. Am I what God wants me to be? In God's eyes and His others' eyes. Because look, when the vertical is right, the horizontal will be right. Correct? Next question we want to ask is, where am I going? Where am I going? And this is eye-opening because Romans chapter 12, 1 and 2, very, very familiar portion of Scripture, says these words. You've heard these before. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So Paul begins these words with an appeal. The old King James says, I beseech you, or it means like a begging. You know, get away from the norm. You don't have to be that way. So he says, are we going that way? Are we going that route? Are we heading toward that? Where are we going? And so, as light bearers, because Jesus said, even at the beginning of his ministry, as he first preached in Matthew chapter 5, long sermon called the Sermon on the Mount, began with the Beatitudes. He gets right in and he says, you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. And so as you're reevaluating yourself, are you light and life to the lost and also to one another? And so Romans 12 talks about two things. First, a life of worship, because it talks about being living sacrifices that are holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. And when you talk about a life of worship, many times we define worship as singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. But here, look very closely, where it says, which is your spiritual worship. The word worship, in that portion there, the King James says, which is your reasonable service. The Greek says, and you're gonna catch right on this because you know Greek, right? Tain, logatein, latireon. which is really speaking to the fact of glorifying God. That's what it means, glorifying God. And you can't glorify God in yourself. It's a spiritual activity. The Spirit of God comes in you. Because people can say words. God wants the heart. Amen. Glorifying God with our lives, the issue and the intent of living sacrifices. Forsake self to glorify God. And what's the result? We're light bearers. We're light bearers. So it's a life of worship. That's verse 1. That's what it's talking about. But not only that, but a life transformed. And verse 2 comes out. Because a life transformed begins with mind renewal. That's why it says by the renewing of your mind. Now here we are, reevaluating and renewing ourselves toward the call of the Almighty. Beginning with mind renewal, kingdom thinking means you consult the kingdom handbook. Anybody have a kingdom handbook today? Hold it up. Your kingdom handbook. There it is. And we can't leave it on the shelf, sitting there. We've got to consult the handbook. What God thinks, what He wants, that's the mind renewal. When you come up with something, is that what God thinks? Or something coming into my mind that just sounds profound. Consulting the kingdom handbook. So it's reevaluation time. Am I going where God wants me to go? Am I forsaking self? Am I bearing His light? It's time to renew. It's time to renew. So these verses here, particularly in 1 Corinthians 6, I want you to kind of mark those in your Bible and consult it through this series. Because you don't want to be in that unrighteous, non-inheriting the kingdom of God state. Even though you are part of the kingdom. But you do want to be, like it says in verse 11, washed, sanctified, justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God being with Him. So what does this mean? Well, it means, not yet. What it means is, and you have this in your notes. I thought I put it up there, but I didn't. Spiritual growth. Oh, by the way, there's a third point next time. I could see with everything I was saying that no way we're going to get to number 3. So that'll be next time. But look at your notes there, and you see right there under the conclusion that says spiritual growth means less and less of you, more and more of Christ in you. So let me say that again, because that's a lot of stuff to write down, especially if you don't see it up here. Spiritual growth means less and less of you and more of Christ in you. Let me read you a couple of illustrations I came across, of all places this week, Facebook. And I have some friends. I have a pastor friend out in, I believe it's Seattle area, Mars Hill Church, and Mark Driscoll. And he says this. He says, 2 years ago, a young woman at Mars Hill Church became pregnant out of wedlock. She gave birth a year ago and has been raising the little girl with her parents. During this time, the young woman has had incredible growth in her relationship with Jesus and with her parents. Recently, a young man in the church asked her to marry. She dedicated her daughter a couple of months ago to the Lord in front of her new church family. So, things happen in our life that are non-kingdom stuff, but the kingdom can grow out of that, right? That's what happened. And then I thought this one was kind of intriguing. I don't really know where it comes from, but this is the story that they gave. A member of the church who had previously been attending services regularly stopped going. After a few weeks, the pastor decided to visit him. It was a chilly evening. The pastor found the man at home alone, sitting before a blazing fire. Guessing the reason for his pastor's visit, the man welcomed him, led him to a comfortable chair near the fireplace, and waited. The pastor made himself at home but said nothing. In the grave silence, he contemplated the dance of the flames around the burning logs, and after some minutes, the pastor took the fire tongs, carefully picked up a brightly burning ember, and placed it to one side of the hearth, all alone. Then he sat back in his chair, still silent. The host watched all this in quiet contemplation. As the one lone ember's flame flickered and diminished, there was a momentary glow, and then this fire was no more. Soon it was cold and dead. Not a word had been spoken since the initial greeting. The pastor glanced at his watch and realized it was time to leave. He slowly stood up, picked up the cold, dead ember, and placed it back in the middle of the fire. Immediately it began to glow, once more with light and warmth of the burning coals around it. As the pastor reached the door to leave, his host said, with a tear running down his cheek, "Thank you so much for your visit and especially for the fiery sermon." I'll be back in church next Sunday. We live in a world today which tries to say too much with too little. Consequently, if you listen, sometimes the best sermons are the ones left unspoken. But the key is, God has left us here for a reason. He's left us to be part of one another, right? He's left us to impact others in the body, people in the world, with the light of Christ. And so re-evaluation must lead to renewal. Now, dear beloved, I am not going to make this a time of just giving you some rosy words from the rosy word. And I don't say that disrespectfully. But I am asking you to begin a growth pattern this year in 2014 that's going to shine a light that you can't shine yourself. And we can impact one another and our world in ways that we cannot do by ourselves, even with all the Bible knowledge in the world, right? Because we're not looking for people that are puffed up, we're looking for people that are humble. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, He will lift you up. We have a great opportunity to advance ourselves as kingdom people, and then to advance the kingdom. And so prayer is a vital thing. And what I'm about to show you talks about prayer, but it also talks about how we, as God's people, are being called. We're being called to get out of our seats, to even come forward to Him and cry out to Him. We're going to give you opportunities, not today as such, but in the weeks ahead, to forsake all and to come to Him and to publicly display that you want to see a pattern of growth in 2014. That not only do we shine to one another, but we shine out there. Would it be so exciting to find more and more and more Bristolites being impacted with the gospel? And then all the communities that are around us as well, the community that you live in. So check out the song, which is asking us to come before. And give ourselves to Him.
If you gotta start somewhere, why not here? If you gotta start sometime, why not now? If we gotta start somewhere, I say here. If we gotta start sometime, I say now. From the far, there is hope in the distance. From cathedrals to third world missions. Love will fall to the earth like a crashing wave. Tonight's the night for the sons and the saints to worlds collide in a beautiful display. It's all love.
Life to empowered kingdom living that's going to impact one another and impact the world. And 2014 is right here, right at the beginning. We're just 5 days into it, and the line is being drawn, and we can cross over, you know, for the way things were to the way things God wants it to be. So where are you? And where are you going? And the third facet we'll touch upon next week. As we seek to commit ourselves to cross that line, to shine the light, we're going to spend with time with our Savior in communion as well next time. What a place to start. What a place to begin. A renewal in our lives and our hearts.